You're listening to the audio production of Failing Forward, Turning Mistakes into Stepping Stones for Success by John C. Maxwell, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by Henry O. Arnold. New introduction read by the author.
Hi, John Maxwell here. I'd like to talk to you about my book, Failing Forward. I had an interesting seminar many years ago in Dallas, Texas, and I was talking about failure. It really is one of my favorite subjects because failure just stumps so many people and keeps them from reaching their potential. And so I was talking to the audience, and I just got inspired, as I do many times, and my speech kind of probably went to a level that normally wouldn't go to. And so I was trying to encourage the people that, you know, failure is not final. And I looked at them, and finally I said to them, I said, I'll tell you what every one of us need to do in this audience. I said, every one of us need to fail forward. And as soon as I said we need to fail forward, the audience just absolutely gasped. I mean, it was audible. I mean, it was like, and everybody looked at each other, and then they broke out into applause because I gave them a phrase that they connected with, fail forward. Now, a lot of my books come out of my speaking. One of the things I love about being a speaker, communicator, is that I get to try stuff out, and the audience very quickly will tell you if it's good or not. It's kind of like comedians who go to all the comedy clubs, and they throw the material out, and when they're done, guess what? If you throw the material out to the people, they'll throw the material out that you don't use anymore. Hey, when you say something, they just kind of look at you and you thought, okay, that one didn't work. We'll cross that one off of our sheet. But people give you immediate reinforcement, either positive or negative. And that day, when I said we all need to fail forward, and there was that gasp, and everybody looked at each other and they applauded, I thought, oh my gosh. While I'm still talking, I thought, that would be a great book title. And so it became a great book title. I would like to take just a couple of minutes and talk to you about failure because I still feel that it trips up way too many people. And I think one of the reasons is because we look at failure and think it's directly opposite of success. It's kind of like success is to our right and everything is good, and failure is to our left and everything is wrong. And I just want you to know that failure is not the opposite of success. In fact, I don't put them across from each other as far as opposing one another. I put them together. In fact, I tell people, failure is essential for your success. And let me just explain that for a moment. I've never known a person successful that did not have failure included in their story. Never one time have I said, okay, talk to me about how you achieved this, how you succeeded here. Failure is in every story. Failure is in every success story. It's not the opposite of failure. Success and failure are friends. In fact, I tell people, embrace failure. It's part of the process of getting to where you want to be. Let me explain. I have a wonderful company called the John Maxwell Team. It's a coaching company. It's the most successful, largest coaching company in the world. The secret of our success in building this company is what we call the success cycle. And the success cycle is, it's a cycle. It's not a journey. If it's a journey, you can pass the destination and never come back to it. This is a cycle, which means there are five things we repeatedly, continually cycle through and do. And I'll give them to you quickly because this is about failing forward, about failure and how it can be an asset to you. The cycle is simple. We test, we fail, we learn, we improve, and then and only then, we re-enter. And as soon as we re-enter, guess what we do? We go right through the cycle again. We test, fail, learn, improve, re-enter. Test, fail, learn, improve, re-enter. Wow. Now, if you test, you're going to fail because you're doing things you've never done before and there's a high failure rate. But that's okay because you've got to penetrate the unknown to be successful in life. And so with testing, after we test, there's a lot of failure. And when people say, well, how will I know that my failure was a success? It's very simple. Failure is always a success when you learn from it. So we test, we fail, and we learn. Now, what's the value of learning? Improving. Learning is not just because I had an academic change of thought. It's because I applied something in my life. So we fail, we test, and then we fail, and then we learn, and then we improve. And only after we improve do we reenter. But as I think of that cycle of success, it's just not complete without testing and failure. And by the way, it's a cycle. When we reenter, guess what we get to do again? Test, fail. The cycle never stops. And that's why I say, if you want to be successful, learn to fail forward. You learn to fail forward when you learn from your failure and improve your life because of it. So, my friend, let's today fail forward.
Preface. Becoming a real success. As I speak around the country, people often ask me why I write books. I've been asked that question so many times that I want to give you the answer before you begin listening to the first chapter of Failing Forward. I have dedicated my life to adding value to people. It's the reason I teach conferences, record lessons on cassette, create training videos, and write books. It's the reason I lead my organization, the Enjoy Group. I want to see people achieve. I want to see each person I meet become a real success. I believe that to succeed, a person needs only four things. You can remember them by thinking of the word real. Relationships. The greatest skill needed for success is the ability to get along with other people. It impacts every aspect of a person's life. Your relationships make you or they break you. Equipping. One of the most significant lessons I've learned is that those closest to you determine the level of your success. If your dreams are great, you achieve them only with a team. Attitude. People's attitudes determine how they approach life day to day. Your attitude, more than your aptitude, will determine your altitude. Leadership. Everything rises and falls on leadership. If you desire to lift the lid on your personal effectiveness, the only way to do it is to increase your leadership skills. If you read or listen to any one of my books, you can be sure that it seeks to add value in one of these four areas. I've written this particular book to change your attitude about failure. Listen to it, absorb it, and allow it to help you turn your mistakes into stepping stones for success. My desire is that failing forward will add value to your life. Chapter 1. What's the main difference between people who achieve and people who are average? We are all failures, at least all the best of us are. J. M. Barrie. What makes achievers excel? Why do people skyrocket while others plummet? You know what I'm talking about. You can call it luck, blessing, or the Midas touch. Call it whatever you want. But the truth is that some people just seem to achieve incredible things in spite of tremendous difficulties. They finish in the top 5% in nationwide sales for their company after losing key accounts. They find ingenious ways to increase profits for their department in the face of budget cuts. They earn a graduate degree while raising two children as a single parent. They discover awesome business opportunities while colleagues don't see any at all. Or they recruit winner after winner into their organization despite what looks like an anemic labor pool. It doesn't matter what kind of work they do. Wherever they are, they just seem to make things happen. Certainly, all people like to think of themselves as above average, but achievers seem to leave average in the dust. So far behind them that ordinary seems a distant memory. What's the root of achievement? What makes the difference? Why do some people achieve so much? Is it family background? Having a good family growing up is something to be grateful for, but it's not a reliable indicator of achievement. High percentages of successful people come from broken homes. Wealth? No. Some of the greatest achievers come from households of average to below average means. Wealth is no indicator of high achievement, and poverty is no guarantee of low achievement. Opportunity? You know, opportunity is a peculiar thing. Two people with similar gifts, talents, and resources can look at a situation, and one person will see tremendous opportunity while the other sees nothing. Opportunity is in the eye of the beholder. High morals? I wish that were the key, but it's not. I've known people with high integrity who achieve little, and I've known scoundrels who are high producers. Haven't you? The absence of hardship? For every achiever who has avoided tragedy, there's a Helen Keller who overcame extreme disabilities, or a Viktor Frankl who survived absolute horrors. So, that's not it either. No, none of these things are the key. When it comes right down to it, I know of only one factor that separates those who consistently shine from those who don't. The difference between average people and achieving people is their perception of and response to failure. Nothing else has the same kind of impact on people's ability to achieve and to accomplish whatever their minds and hearts desire. What you never learned in school. Soccer player Kyle Rote Jr. remarked, "There is no doubt in my mind that there are many ways to be a winner. But there is only one way to be a loser, and that is to fail and not look beyond the failure." How people see failure and deal with it, whether they possess the ability to look beyond it and keep achieving, impacts every aspect of their lives. Yet, that ability seems difficult to acquire. Most people don't know where to start looking to get it. Even positive people have a tough time learning how to see failure positively. For example, I'm known to be a very positive person. My book, The Winning Attitude, has been in print for more than 15 years. But I haven't always been good at failing forward. I wasn't properly prepared for it. It's certainly not something they tried to teach me in school. And kids today don't get it there either. In fact, the school environment often reinforces people's worst feelings and expectations about failure. Take a look at some of my previous attitudes toward failure and see if your experience is similar. 1. I feared failure. An experience I had in college, along with my response to it, is typical of what many students encounter. On the first day of class, when I was a freshman, the professor walked into my History of Civilization class and boldly declared, "Half of you in this room will not pass this class." What was my first response? Fear. Up to that time, I had never failed a class, and I did not want to start failing all of a sudden. So the first question I asked myself was, "What does the professor want?" School became a game that I wanted to win. I recall that I once memorized 83 dates for a test in that class because my teacher believed that if you could cite the dates, you had mastered the material. I got an A on the test, but 3 days later, I had forgotten all the information. I managed to avoid the failure I had feared, but I had not really accomplished anything. 2. I misunderstood failure. What is failure? As a child, I thought it was a percentage. 69 and lower meant failure. 70 and above signified success. That thinking didn't help me. Failure isn't a percentage or a test. It's not a single event. It's a process. 3. I was unprepared for failure. When I graduated from college with my bachelor's degree, I finished in the top 5% of my class. It didn't mean a thing. I had played the school game successfully, and I had absorbed a lot of information, but I wasn't at all prepared for what was ahead of me. I found that out in my first job. As the pastor in a small rural church, I worked very hard that first year. I did everything the people might expect of me, and then some. But to be honest, I was as concerned about getting everyone to like me as I was with helping people. In the type of church I led, each year the people voted to decide whether to allow the leader to keep his job. And many of the leaders I knew over the years loved to brag about the unanimous affirming votes they received from their people. My expectations were high as I prepared to receive my first unanimous vote. Imagine my surprise when the votes came back 31 yeses, 1 no, and 1 abstention. I was devastated. After I went home that night, I called my father, who was a veteran pastor, former district superintendent in the denomination, and college president. "Dad," I lamented, I can't believe it. I work so hard for those people. I've done everything I can. I was at the point of tears. Somebody actually voted against me and wanted me to leave the church. And an abstention is as good as a no. Should I leave and go to another church? To my shock, I heard laughter on the other end of the phone. No, son, stay there, my dad said as he chuckled. That's probably the best vote you'll ever receive. A new course. At that moment, I realized what an unrealistic view I had of success and failure. If anything, my college experience had reinforced the wrong notions I had about failure. And as I've helped leaders to grow and develop through the years, I've seen that most people are in the same boat. In Leadership Magazine, J. Wallace Hamilton states, "The increase of suicides, alcoholics, and even some forms of nervous breakdowns is evidence that many people are training for success when they should be training for failure. Failure is far more common than success. Poverty is more prevalent than wealth, and disappointment more normal than arrival." Training for failure. That is a great concept, and it's the idea that prompted me to write this book. Right now, you are getting the chance to sign up with me for a class you were never offered in school. I want to help you train for failure. I want you to learn how to confidently look the prospect of failure in the eye and move forward anyway. Because in life, the question is not if you will have problems, but how you are going to deal with your problems. Are you going to fail forward or backward? Putting a new face on obstacles. When I think of people who were able to look trouble in the eye and forge ahead, one of the first who comes to mind is Mary Kay Ash. She has built quite an organization. During the last 4 or 5 years, I've had many opportunities to speak to the people in her cosmetics company about leadership. In fact, as I travel around the country doing conferences and seminars, it seems that no matter where I speak, there are always at least a dozen Mary Kay consultants in attendance. I admire Mary Kay. She overcame a lot of obstacles in her career, and she never let failure get the better of her. Mary Kay's first career was in direct sales, and she was quite successful. But she also found that it was difficult for a woman to progress in the corporate world, especially in the 1950s and early 1960s, even after 25 years of success. She says, "I had worked my way up to being a member of the board of the company I was with, only to find that, even though our sales force was made up entirely of women, governed by an all-male board, my opinions were of no value. I constantly heard, 'Mary Kay, you are thinking like a woman again.' I felt rejection in the worst form. So, I decided to retire." Her retirement didn't last long. By the time a month passed, she was stir-crazy. She was ready to start her own business. If she was going to encounter obstacles, they would be there only because she brought them on herself. She decided on a cosmetics business that would give every woman who worked in it unlimited opportunities. She purchased the formulas to the best beauty products she'd ever found, worked up a marketing plan, and prepared to set up a corporation. Trouble. It didn't take long for her to hit her first obstacle. When she visited her attorney to make legal arrangements for the corporation, he insulted her and predicted her failure. "Mary Kay," he said, "if you are going to throw away your life savings, why don't you just go directly to the trash can? It will be so much easier than what you are proposing." Her accountant spoke to her in similar terms. Despite attempts to discourage her, she moved ahead. She sank her $5,000 life savings into her new business, every cent she had. She put her husband in charge of the administrative side of things as she worked feverishly to prepare the products, design the packaging, write the training materials, and recruit consultants. They were making wonderful progress. But then, a month before she was to open for business, her husband died of a heart attack right at their kitchen table. Most people would never have been able to go on after that. They would have accepted defeat and faded away, but not Mary Kay. She kept going, and on September 13, 1963, she launched her business. Today, The company has more than $1 billion in annual sales, employs 3,500 people, and empowers 500,000 direct sales consultants in 29 markets worldwide. And Mary Kay Ash has received just about every award an entrepreneur could dream of, despite adverse circumstances.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.